after some years it is to be recycled, that is possible or not. So that is normally our strategy as far as using materials is concerned.
Kanika, would you like to add some?
I can't let Yatneshji not answer and share his views in terms of the, you know, Nerolac truly champions sustainability and I think the right usage of products. So would you share some more in addition to what we heard you?
nothing less like there's a happy smile. And within 6 months of time, due to school has reduced the overall energy in a 65%. So I think we all have to just take this cycle and we have to bring the awareness forward to the consumer, because we will never have any sustainable business asset. We have to think.
I think, you know, last month I was actually in Delhi. We had a, you know, one of our distinguished sustainability lecture series, and we had on the panel Mr. Shashi Prabhu, the ex-minister for power, and IGBC US chairman, the CEO. And I think what the minister said actually, that sustainability and the way to promote is not something at the hands of the architect and designers of this country, but I think it has to start at the very grassroots level, the way we talk, you know, bring up our kids and inculcate that basic discipline. So I think that's something very interesting. And one thing which is about innovation, and I think every big thing happens if you're really innovative. Kanika, what do you think innovation has to do in terms of sustainability?
A lot. Because whilst we can argue that we were always sustainable as our ancestors, today, to apply sustainability to today's building, you need today's innovations. For a small scale building, maybe you can apply the traditional concepts, and maybe you should apply the traditional concepts. But for buildings with larger scale, higher buildings, you need innovation. You need innovation in materials, in technology, in facade systems, extremely important. And in lighting systems, in these intelligent Ideaz, and making sad and happy faces for lights. You need technology all the way through, right from what kind of anti-termite treatment you're doing in the foundation to what kind of lighting you're using right at the end of the building. So right from the start to the end, you need technology all the way through, and innovation in technology all the way through. Definitely.
So, all right. I'm just going to you talk about sustainable luxury, and you know there is a tagline for ITC saying responsible luxury. I would like to have the views of the panel in terms of how sustainability and how luxury can coexist. Mishal, we start with you. I mean, I want everybody's view.
At any given point of time, sustainability is not trying to contradict to any comforts or any luxury that a person should enjoy inside or outside the house. So I don't see a conflict in that. So that's my view on the comforts that are to be provided as a part of sustainability.
I think I would second that. That's absolutely right. I would just share a recent experience I had with one of my clients, where after a lot of trying to convince him to use certain sustainable materials, he was not getting convinced for LED either. He wanted a luxurious house. So my final call was, look, sustainability is luxurious. So I am giving you a very expensive material, which is sustainable. So sustainability is the luxury. So you're going to call your house luxurious because it's sustainable. So I gave an absolutely different idea to him, and he was like, yes, okay. It's just the way you look at it. It's nowhere in contradiction to luxury. We are not asking you to stay as if you were staying in a village to be sustainable. You can have your lifestyle and still be sustainable and have the amount of spaces and amount of luxury you want and still be sustainable. It's just the choices you make and the way you try and understand the subject. It's just about that.
Sure.
I would just like to add to it, like normally comfort is always linked, or luxury is always linked to price. So that is not actually the case. So whenever we talk about sustainability and comforts, or it is how you feel, how you what you experience inside a space or outside a space. So sustainability never kind of limits us from doing that. So I think anything which is sustainable can be easily very, very comfortable also, not an issue.
Here I'd like to remind you all that probably in school we all learned the 3 R's of sustainability. That is reduce, recycle, and reuse. Now each one needs innovation. So nobody is asking anybody to be uncomfortable anytime. But if you go from one to another, from each R to R, there is one more R I'd like to add, and it's a regenerate. Now that is the thing that you do to your clients or the user, the end user. You to regenerate his confidence in sustainability, and that is how most successful architects who do sustainable buildings can manage it. The third, the fourth R they add, regenerate. Regenerate the confidence in you by using material which is sustainable, by using practices which are sustainable, by being very innovative about reduction, recycling, and reuse. So if you join the four R's, probably you are very innovative and you can be very successful, and you'll not compromise on any comfort level of any client. So that's what my view is.
Lovely. I think I'm going to come back almost to the last of the question, which I'm going to aim at for Kanika. Selling point, I mean, normally in a situation with a client, how do you see sustainability as a brand differentiator?
That's a tough one. See, when I was working in London, my practice in which I was working was involved in doing a lot of BREEAM rated buildings. Now, I think what inspired my company to do those BREEAM rated buildings and what inspired them to market it to the clients was the rating and the funding the UK government gave them for achieving the rating. See, that's the dry truth. So in Europe, you get funded for achieving LEED rating and BREEAM rating, and so you would just do that to get that funding. So whilst we can ignore the monetary part of it, we have to accept that it is the largest player when it comes to people who are really have the capacity to create and to make an impact. People who have the money to make big buildings are the ones who can have the largest impact. And for them, it is the monetary advantage which really sells. So I think if IGBC tomorrow starts thinking like UK and Europe and like the EU, then we could very soon have similar laws where if you're having GRIHA rated buildings, you could be benefited in this way and that way, and that could be a really big benefit for the people with the money who are making the larger impact. See, that's I think the real truth for whether we like it or not. For architects to be able to sell sustainability to clients, I think the best way is to make them understand the payback period, as Vishal was saying all the way through. If at all you're paying 10-12% extra, you will end up regaining all that money in the next 10 years. That's extremely important, and it is our job to educate the client with this information. That is the largest selling point for me. The problem with this point is when buildings are made to be rented out. That's where the owner of the building or the maker of the building or the person who's conceiving the building is not the end user. That's when the problem becomes they don't want to spend the 10% extra. The people who are going to rent the building don't want to rent a property which is going to, where they are the sufferers of the payback period. So that's somewhere where we have to probably look more into and probably create a scenario where we can try and sell it in a different way. But where the owner is the end user, there are 1,000 ways you can sell sustainability to the